A few weeks ago, I spent 12 days in San Salvador, Bahamas. It's the furthest south that I've ever been in the Bahamas, and it took about 20 hours on the mailboat to reach there from Nassau. I was there with about 160 other students to participate in GGYA's annual National Adventurous Journey, which is also known as the Bahamas Award Super Expedition, or BASE for short. For those of you that don't know, GGYA is the Governor General's Youth Award Program, and it focuses on developing individual leadership skills in young individuals like myself. I participated in this program all throughout high school, and I had previously completed the bronze and silver levels prior to going to San Salvador. While in San Salvador, we were stationed at the San Salvador High School, except for the 4 days and three nights that we were on the gold expedition. The expedition was no doubt a serious test of mental and physical strength, along with some basic survival skills, such as fire making and first aid. Over this period, we walked the better end of 60 miles during the day, while heat on another level slowly roasted us from the outside in, and it was mostly through powder-like sand. In the evenings, we pitched tents on amazing beaches around the island with gorgeous views, which made me realize that not all Bahamian beaches are of the same grade of beauty. We made campfires each night, which somehow converted sandy hot dogs, undercooked rice, and other sandy things to delicious five-star meals every night. And of course, there were the bee-like mosquitoes, which had taken lessons from wasps and stinging, that ate me alive. But regardless of these hardships, I had a great time. And if I could, I would do it all again. It was an amazing eye-opening experience in many ways. I met students from islands all around the Bahamas, including Grand Bahama, Abaco, Andros, New Providence, and Inagua. I was very fond of one aspect of the experience that the others did not like too much, which was the fact that our electronic devices were safely stored away from us for the duration of the trip. This forced us to communicate in the old-fashioned way for entertainment. So we had lots of conversations with each other, mostly about sporting interests, who would be subject to the next prank, and many other things. But the funniest times were hearing about what slang is used on the other islands. So a person from Nassau would say, "What do I say?" Oh, yeah, daddy. But most often our conversations ended up talking about our high school experiences, since most of us had recently graduated. What became apparent was that there are inequalities in the Bahamian educational system, depending on which school you attend or which island you live on. Some of the things that others said really impacted me and made me feel as if I had taken the quality of my high school education for granted, because it seemed normal to me, and I never really thought about if others had the same advantages as I did. So I will focus on three major disadvantages that stood out to me as I listened to other people's academic experiences. The first thing is that their teachers are not actually specialists in the subjects they're teaching. My friend goes to school in Andros, and he told me that his physics teacher was actually a mathematics teacher, and that his teacher had admitted to the class that he was learning the material at the same time that he was teaching it to the class. In the August 4, 2011 edition of the Nassau Guardian, the Director of Education, Lionel Sands, stated, and I quote, "The Department of Education does not have a sufficient complement of teachers to teach the subjects of physics, math, chemistry, and several other technical areas," end quote. Also, on August 16th, 2013, the Minister of Education, the Honorable Jerome Fitzgerald, stated in a Tribune article that finding qualified mathematics teachers was and still is a problem. So I guess it's safe to assume that the situation in Andros is neither isolated nor is it new. The second thing is the wide variety in the range in the use of technology in the classrooms. There are schools which have televisions, CD players, DVD players, computers, the internet, and smart boards and use them, such as my school here in Grand Bahama and others. There are schools which have these items but do not use them, such as the school that my friend attends, where he says they have smart boards but they never use them. And there are schools which have none of these items, or mostly none of them, such as a school in Treasure Key that was recently featured on a Bahamian news network, ZNS, that is hoping to receive cable television for the first time this school year. The other thing that I noticed was that on some islands, there are no bookstores which sell textbooks or other specialized stationery, such as graph paper. So this makes the inconvenience in obtaining these materials of a huge disadvantage, but still not as big of a disadvantage as if they could not receive them due to a financial or some other consideration. I have gone through every year of my schooling with the necessary workbooks and textbooks that I needed each year, so I understand the value of having these items as reference tools. To me, the key to furthering Bahamian development is improving our educational system, specifically by bringing it into the 21st century. When I recollect the conversations that I had with the guys on GGYA, I started to think that the Bahamian educational experience has not changed much since my parents' time. On the other hand, technology is leaps and bounds ahead of where it was 30 years ago. So here's my idea. Let's make technology a more prominent role in our educational system. Question: how much of the national educational budget is specifically marked for ensuring that schools have items such as computers, televisions, and smart boards? Internet services are available on every island, but are all schools connected? I'm just asking. In today's world, these things are considered basic necessities, along with pens, notebooks, and chalkboards. So, here are a few examples of how we can integrate technology into our educational system. The first thing is that if a school has a smart board and an internet connection, they can use interactive calls via Skype to share content. So in the case of the school that does not have the physics teacher specialist, they can tune into the classroom of another school on another island, and then they would be able to receive the content. Yes, of course, things would have to be worked out, you know, schedules would have to be synchronized and other things would have to be done. But the point is, it can be done. Yes. And that the benefits would outweigh the negatives in the long run. Also, teachers love to bring in speakers to address their classes on topics on a real-world perspective. So, they can use the smart board and set up a Skype call. That way, they would no longer be restricted to the residents of their islands that they can call upon. In reality, they can have a speaker from anywhere in the world. I'm not sure that people of my parents' generation understand how important YouTube is as a source of entertainment to today's youth. So much so now that some people spend more time watching YouTube videos than they actually do watching television. YouTube is filled with millions of videos on just about any topic that you can think of. And the educational value in YouTube is just as great or greater than the entertainment value. So it really should be a teacher's best friend. Many of my courses in high school had a practical component. So take out your books, copy this down off of the board. Could not always cut it. So we did a few experiments in science. Some could not be done though due to a lack of materials or equipment, or they were just too dangerous to carry out in a school lab. So what did my teacher do? She went on the computer, pulled up the experiment on YouTube, and we were able to view it. There you have it, YouTube. So we also did the occasional field trip in geography to view coastal features. But for those features that are not available here in the Bahamas, such as volcanoes, there was a YouTube video for that. And we were actually able to view these things without actually just staring at a still picture in a textbook. My music teacher in high school was a pianist, and I'm a drummer. So how did I learn to play a flam, a three-note ruff, or play the cha-cha? She sent me emails with links of YouTube drummers that actually demonstrated these things. There you have it, YouTube, the teacher's best friend. My solution to fix the problem that some students have in obtaining textbooks is for schools to take on the pilot project of using ebooks. Now, so instead of sending home a book list that can easily add up to $600 or more, a tablet could be listed instead, along with the necessary information on where to download these books. This is already being done in some places in the world. E-books cost about 60% less than a printed textbook, and besides that, they do not use paper, and the tablet that they are stored on does not weigh 40 pounds like my backpack did when it was stuffed with my textbooks. According to websites like coursesmart.com and textbooks.com, e-books can be used both on and offline, and the apps needed to use them are free. Unfortunately, I only found one or two literature textbooks that we use here in the schools in the Bahamas. I could not find any other books. Most were college texts. But my search was rather limited. So I'm hoping that by the time my kids are ready to enter high school, the use of e-books would be the norm. Meanwhile, with a tablet and an internet connection, students can download a free Bible app to use in religion class. Or they can check out sparknotes.com to help them with writing literature essays or study for literature tests. There are also fun game and quiz sites that students can use to help them study. For example, my aunt, she stumbled across a website called jetpunk.com. It is filled with a plethora of user-made quizzes, some of which are relevant to the subjects that we studied in school. So for someone who's a verbal learner, like myself, or at least she says, I found it very helpful to type these words down. And the beat the clock format made it seem like I was playing a game rather than actually having a study session. I understand that there are about 100 of us here today. How many of you have a son, daughter, nephew, grandchild, or whatever, in high school that does not have a smartphone? 1%. I met students from Abaco to Inagua on GGYA, and every single one of them had a smartphone. And they were pretty uncomfortable with being without it for about a week. Understandably enough, because it is our lifeline. It is our social media hub, it is our camera, it is our voice recorder, it is our music player, and so many other things. It really is a teen necessity. And yes, I know smartphones are banned in schools, you know, and cyberbullying, mindless texting, and sending nonsensical videos gets all of the attention. But the point is, the capabilities of a smartphone can go far beyond that and can be used for educational purposes. I will use WhatsApp as an example. Making a group on WhatsApp is as easy as touching the screen, and adding people to the group is just a matter of punching numbers in. Everyone is constantly checking their phone, and when you send a message in a WhatsApp group, everyone receives it. So, this past school year, my friends and I, we put this to the test. We made a WhatsApp group specifically for physics and chemistry, where we quizzed each other, sent reminders of what was to be brought to class the next day, sent reminders of due dates, and many other things. I really benefited from this because it was really convenient and helpful, and everyone else that shared that experience with me felt the same way. So, here's my proposed school list for the 21st century. Pencil cases, textbooks, and social media. Thank you.